First of all, thank you very much for being here. I'd like to thank also the organizer for making this happen. We organize a lot of events around the world, so we know it's a crazy amount of work. So if we can give them a round of applause for everything they've done so far, that would be highly appreciated. Thank you. So about me. Stéphane and Louis said, I'm one of the founders of Seedstars. We started the group 3 years ago, and I'll get to the details of what we do. First comment is, it's not usual that I wear a tie like this, so I'll just throw the question, why do you think I wear a tie? Any idea? Correct. Congrats. So that's one time of the year where you what lifetime, hopefully, that you have to wear a tie. And second reason, I needed a cool picture for social media. Briefly about my background, worked in merger and acquisitions for a while, cross-border transaction is in Europe, sold a couple of Swiss watch companies to Chinese, and then worked on a couple of tech deals. After that, I founded my first tech companies, sold it, and then with two friends, started Seedstars 3 years and a half ago now. Seedstars is more than me. It's definitely a lot of great people. So we're a bit less than 60 around the group, directly working on two main things. So we are hard believers on those three things. One is entrepreneurship. It's definitely the best way to change things around this world, and we think we can have a great impact by building and investing in entrepreneurs. Second is of course about tech. Tech is speeding things up, and we are part of this. And last but not least, where everything is happening today is in emerging markets. We focus only on four key regions: Africa, Middle East, Asia, and Latin America. And that's three things together is what we do today. So trying to have an impact in this world, building or investing in tech entrepreneurs, and bringing entrepreneurship to the next level in those countries. So how do we do this? First is we started with company building. So pretty similar to the Rocket Internet model. We put together team, capital, and an ID, usually our own ID, to build tech companies in those markets. So we started with fintech, because that's Swiss people, that's what we knew how to do. Next year, we're kicking off edtech, and we're also looking at e-health and agri-tech as well. But it's going to be for the, I think, next few years. So we usually own 100% of those companies, and we give up to 20% to the founders, but they also have non-dilution rights in the first round. On the other side, we act as a typical VC, so we invest in early stage entrepreneurs, really anywhere around the world, as long as it's in emerging markets. Ticket size, usually it's between 50 to 500K USD. Average, we're always mostly the first investor. We invest around 300K into those companies. So how we do this is we build first the platform. So same thing for us as entrepreneurs. We started by building the first couple of companies bearing the Seedstars name. Seedstars World is what we're known for. The largest tech competition in emerging markets, this year covering 70 countries. So we probably heard about us in one of those regions. So now we have five teams spread in all of these key locations, and they're responsible to travel. So it's a time-consuming job, traveling in 15-plus countries every year, meeting entrepreneurs, selecting those guys, inviting them to a regional summit. Last year for Africa, I was in Morocco. This year it's gonna be in Kigali. And then inviting those guys in Switzerland for a big summit. The second pillar, and probably the most important one, is the academy. That's how we train and educate tech entrepreneurs. So for us, it starts with a paying program. So Those guys are paid to learn about entrepreneurship. So we have three tracks, a business track, a dev track, and an online marketing track. So it's a 6 to 9 months program based on where they start. And after that, they get a job within one of the Seedstars company. Then, of course, as a company builder, we have our own labs agency, and we run also the largest co-working and co-living spaces in emerging markets. Hopefully, we'll definitely be in one of your country. So if you have any opportunity on that part of the thing, this is what we're going to focus on next year. Couple of picture about Seedstars World. So that's, I think, from last year. Those competition, the hubs, and now down to the businesses, which is what focus our attention every day. So it's just two quick examples. So one company that works pretty well today that we started in Nigeria 6 months ago is Quick Check. So we do small loans on mobile, Android, less than 30 days, less than $100, and you can get your loan in less than 48 hours. We charge between 0.5 and 1% per day, so it's very profitable, but it solves a big problem in those markets. Second one on the minority side, so on the VC side of the group, is a South African company. So I took two examples of the portfolio, but we have today 15 investments, roughly a bit less than 15 investments on the minority side and 10 companies on the majority side. So Giraffe, they do recruitment platforms. You can get 7 people to your doors, highly qualified people to your doors, ready for an interview. And I'll get back to that. So the rest of the presentation is, so there's just an overview of what Seedstars is. So I think we are good at two things. One is starting companies, from taking it from zero to one. So I spoke to a couple of you guys today, and apparently you're like roughly at that stage. So either you already launched your product and you already have an MVP and you're ready to tackle or get more clients, or you just finish it up and are ready to scale. So that's the focus of today's presentation. So I'll try to make it as interactive as possible, but it's difficult being me on stage alone and you sitting here. So don't hesitate to interrupt me if you have questions about anything. I'd be happy to dig into something specific. It's difficult to do something precise when you don't exactly know the audience and your stage. But that's basically my understanding of where you guys stand. So you all have a great idea that I'm pretty sure of. And for us, we know that as an investor and as entrepreneurs, every idea is pretty cool and pretty good. No matter what, if you have time, it will make money. Maybe it's not going to be a $1 billion company, but who cares? You know, you're going to make money at the end of the day, and that's the most important part. So, don't stop working on things that you love to do. It will turn into something. The three following advice is what we look at when we start a new company as a company builder. So basically for us is solving one of the biggest problems. So when we started with Quick Check, for example, the small loans that I showed you around, it was, okay, we want to try to solve the fintech issue. So they don't have access to the banking system. How can we lend money easily and quickly to any Africans or any people in emerging markets? I mean, we know it's a big problem. You know, at the end of the month, you don't have money to pay rent. You don't have money to finance your working capital as a micro entrepreneur. We come in and it solves a very big issue. So that's, you know it's a big market. And for us as also investors, it's good enough to know that you're really solving a problem. And I think a couple of projects I've seen discussing the at least mainly yesterday was about solving those big issues. So that's, for me, is a check mark. On the other side, it's the size of the market, of course. So it should be big enough I mean, if you look at success cases, if you can call them success, but I imagine so, like Uber or Airbnb, I mean, you know, it's huge industries that they're tackling. So first thing, you know, is existing market that you're trying to disrupt. And on the other side, you have potentially new market that you're trying to tackle. And that's, you potentially will be creating a new market. And that's what you have to figure out as an entrepreneur. But if you know that your market is big enough, then you'll definitely be into something. And the most important part, sorry for the cheesy picture, it's the best one I found on Google today, is doing something what you love. Every day waking up when you have to work 16 hours a day, 6 or 7 days a week, you better love what you do, otherwise you're gonna struggle and you're gonna stop pretty quickly. So make sure that's you know, what the project or the company that you're working for, working with, is definitely something that you want to do every day, at least for a couple of years, because it's going to be really time-consuming, exhausting, and so on. I don't know if you have questions here about those 3 points, remarks, whatever you want to throw, but that's basically going back to those three things. That's how we select now the companies. Yes, that's how we select the companies that we want to build.
Okay, please, just a small question. I wanted to know, we have to do what we love, or we have to love what we do?
Good one. Thank you. I think both. Both are important. So I don't know if everyone here heard the question: is do we have to do something that we love, or loves something that we do something? Both. Thank you. I think both. In your case, what would be your company, and how do you see things? Which one are you thinking about? Do you do what you love, or? Yeah.
Yeah, as I was saying, I myself, I think that it is more difficult to love what you do than to do what you love. Maybe as far creating a company or being an entrepreneur is concerned, it is difficult. It is difficult sometimes when you don't have money to concentrate on what you love, because sometimes you have opportunities containing some things that are not necessarily what you love, and you have to struggle to get money to do what you love. So maybe in this sense, it's a bit difficult to do what you love. But in fact, indeed, I think it is better to do what you love. Better than love what you do.
Yeah, thank you for that. Quick remark also on that is on our side, for example, now I'm always giving this joke is, I mean, what I love to do as an entrepreneur is building the companies, but now I spend more time doing finance for the group, doing HR. I mean, HR is critical, so of course it's worth my time. Doing fundraising, nobody wants to do fundraising, so I do the fundraising for the companies and so on. So I do a lot of things that I don't like. But at the end, if I look at, you know, the overall scheme of things, you know, it's, you know, I still build companies and I spend maybe 20 to 40% of my time with the companies or building new things. And the rest is all the crap that nobody wants to do. So, I mean, I totally agree with your point. And, I mean, it's always like this, you know, if you at the end, even if it's spending 10% or 20% of your time on something that you really love, it's maybe worth the effort. But thank you for the remark. Next is what we try to avoid most of the time is... So this one is pretty cool, but it's failing fast. So when we start new companies, some of them fail, and we try to kill them or fail them as fast as possible. It's definitely not easy, and so we struggle every day to kill new companies that we've started, because we always say, okay, there's a potential. You know, one of my first point was any ideas is good. I'm pretty sure of that, and you know, it's just giving enough time to turn a good idea into a profitable company, or at least a break-even company. It will happen, I think, for any idea. That then it's just a question of time. So you need to make sure that you have enough time, but you know, don't spend 3-5 years on something that has no real potential. So try to, you know, cut things and move into something else. Could be a simple pivot or something a bit different that you were doing, but try to make it as soon as possible. This one is pretty famous. You know, even us on our side, we spend way too much time on, you know, building the product, trying to make it as perfect as possible. I mean, of course. I mean, if you look at, I don't know if I have them, but maybe on the backup slides, if you look at, you know, first version of Twitter or Facebook or so on, I mean, they were pretty ugly. And if you look at our versions when we launch, sometimes it's just, you know, a front page that we've done on Strikingly or similar services. So don't be afraid to launch as soon as possible your ideas. And try them on the markets. I mean, the most difficult part for any company, and it's the next few slides, is about selling and making sure your product has customers. Second things that, or third things that we tend to forget is about tracking. Make sure that you have, you know, all the tracking tools in place, Google Analytics. This one is Crazy Egg, for example, that we use a lot. You know, if you want to take a good decision, is it now the good time to, you know, cut this company or this project that I'm working on? Is it bringing enough value to the company? You need to have as many data as possible. So make sure that you have all the information as an entrepreneur to take the right decision and make the right call. And this one I really love is, you know, all around, and we bootstrap, you know, the whole group with everything we had, and we're still investing a lot of time and effort and money as well into Seedstars today. So it's about, you know, this big dilemma between unicorns and cockroaches. And I think especially in emerging markets, you know, there's not as much capital available as you could find in Europe or in the US and so on. So you guys need to be profitable. You need to find things that are bringing revenue from day one. Otherwise, you won't last, you know, more than what you have until you can survive. But that's, for me, the best skill and threat that you can get as an entrepreneur is this resilience of trying and making sure you get as soon as possible to the break even so you can survive as long as possible. The good example I always give is Argentinians. I don't know if there's any Argentinians in your room, but those guys have been, you know, through a lot in terms of politics, FX devaluation, you know, not trusting their governments and so on. And usually, if you look at Latin America and also around the world, it's usually the best entrepreneurs that we can find comes from Argentina. Just because they had so many problems, it make them, you know, not trust their governments, make finding solution, you know, being the cockroach and surviving everything. Those guys are really amazing. And I think that's something that you guys will have. I mean, it's really complicated into those markets. You have to find solution, you have to make it happen. And I think that's really something, a plus that you guys will have if you compare with any other entrepreneurs around the world. And my last point is about marketing and sales. So I heard so many entrepreneurs, I think exactly at your stage, thinking that money and fundraising or something else will solve any problems, because you'll do PR, you'll do SEM, so AdWords or Facebook or SEO and so on, but that's not the answer. Any companies that we've built, we almost invested very little money, sometimes it's $500, $1,000 and so on, to try it out and so on. You have to, take your phone, schedule meeting, whatever, you have to sell. That's the most important part. So don't do those, I'll do a nice marketing campaign, it has to be perfect and so on. That's not the reality. The reality, and usually the best entrepreneurs are the ones that, take their phone, go to meetings, and, you schedule 100 meetings in a week, and you just go for it. And that's how things are going to happen. It's just by being as aggressive as possible and doing things that don't scale, which is, I think, one of the points. There was this one. So how we do things on our side, most of the time when we have an idea, we don't build a product first. So we just short sell it. And the best example that we have for that is Seedstars World. So the startup competitions that we created on the platform side of the group, which was one of the first company we created. So it's basically, okay, let's sit down, see how we can build a network and get connected in 20 countries the first year with nothing. So we had basically a PowerPoint, no money, just an ID, building a network in emerging markets, touching base with what entrepreneurs, potentially investors and corporates. How do we get those guys into a room? Okay, conference seems to be a great opportunity to get all those guys. Let's do a conference around the world. So we spent 16 hours a day on Skype trying to connect to any friend we had or connection we had or found on LinkedIn, whatever, to do this. So basically it was just a PowerPoint and two guys traveling in those markets trying to organize like similar events that we have today. So we just short sell the whole thing as well to partners, corporate partners that trusted us. We don't know why today, but still here. So it seems that they were happy with the results. So my point is, don't, getting back to that point, that thing is, doing a simple strikingly page or whatever the service you want to use, even if it's a Facebook page, to get signed up to try to sell your product is always the best things to do. And that's always how we start building our companies on our sites before building the product, is testing the idea, can we sell it? And then we figure things out. Quick check. So the small loan was exactly the case. No product, no app. We just built a dump app that you can do in, I think, less than a minute. Upload it on the Android store, and then trying to see if people were willing to download the app and if it was a service they were ready to use or not. So getting back to SEM, so search engine marketing, which is usually mostly AdWords and Facebook, AdWords display or standard. This will not solve your distribution or your sales problem. You have, as I was mentioning before, you have to do things. You have to take your phone, call potential clients, call your customers, make sure that you have, all the information, and that you reach out to the right people, that you understand your sales channel. That's how things are going to happen. And it's not by throwing money at Facebook or Google AdWords that it will solve your distribution channel, your distribution. This one is give you a couple of seconds to read it through, but it's about being as persistent as possible, especially if you're in a B2B business. I think a couple of you guys are in this business. So there's a lot of tools today available to make sure that you can follow through leads. So for example, with Seedstars World, we're in contact with a lot of corporate partners. I think Pauline, who's in the room, going to be next. We send them, you know, 10 emails and so on. You know, it's about being persistent. And at the end, they say, I'm sorry, I didn't get back to you. But, you know, we should definitely try to schedule a call and so on. I mean, it was not the case. She was very responsive. But it's just to give you an example. So when you really, so for example, on our side, the tool we use is one is called WeBump. So you just PCC an email address, and then you know it sends back an email that you can customize. So for example, the first one I usually send back if they don't answer, is like you know, did you get my email? And then you can, you know, follow up after 7 days. 3 days, 10 days, and so on until they get back to you. And usually when someone sends you 5-6 emails in like a month, usually tend to answer at the end. So that's what we do, and we always have a rebump for any email that is important. You just have to send it once, and then everything is taken care of automatically. So, you know, don't be afraid of, you know, following up, sending 100 emails if necessary. That's how we do things. And that's the reality of how things work here. This one is pretty famous. So if I hope you know this guy, Paul Graham for YC, Y Combinator in the US. He mentioned a great sentence. So some people agree with this one, some don't. Do things that don't scale. We're a big fan of it, you know. Great example is their success company, Airbnb. Again, you know, they've done two things that were pretty well. One was, you know, taking photos. So going door to door first to take photos of apartments, uploading them on the platform. And that's one of the hack that made them what they are today. And the second one was, when it was not working well, it's at YC, Paul said, okay, you guys should go door to door and try to sign up as many new apartments as possible. And that's what they've did. So, you know, they had the chance to go to New York from the Valley and then learn about the entrepreneurs, the people they were staying at, their future clients, and then, you know, signing up new apartments on the platform, like this door-to-door, really spending one night every day to new potential customers. So you have to do those things. It's not funny sometimes. Sometimes it is, but it's how things are really done, especially at the beginning, at the stage that you are. So to sum up, that's on our side, basically, how we test a new idea that we have. You know, if we answer yes to any of the four points, or markets, painkillers, and something that we want to do, then we directly get down to business. You know, build a strikingly page. You have hundreds of different services, but that's the one we use. We collect email with SumoMe. We talk to our customers with OLARC. We install analytics, Google crazy hacks I mentioned, and then we experiment. So is it, you know, the ID? Is it the pricing? You can test hundreds of different things. So the sooner you start as an entrepreneur, the better it will be, the better results in the future, because at the end, any ID is great. So you'll find something and you'll make it happen. Questions? Any points that you want me to zoom in? No. So I had two slides left. Yes. This one is important.
Okay, me again. Yeah, I would like to know, you was talking about trying to sell the product before having the product. I'm not sure I've got you well, but I would like to know, when talking about this, are you talking about a prototype or you are talking about an idea, so that as soon as you have an idea, you should start working on talking about your idea, trying to see if the others are ready to use what you are supposed to give them. Or you should just wait to have, for instance, if you want to develop an application, at which moment are you supposed to put it in application? At the moment you get the idea, or at the moment you have the first interface?
Good question. Again, I think it depends, but how we do things, if you look at application, for example, is you don't even know if people are willing to download your application. So the first step is, are people willing to download my application? You don't have to build your application. You just have to fake it, that it's going to be, you know, application about X, Y. It's going to look like this. You can do nice wireframes and so on. And then you can just upload that on Android, and, you know, people can start downloading it. I mean, then it's fake, but at least is, are people willing to download my application to look what it is? You know, that's the first assumption that you're trying to make. So in that case, that's exactly what I would do, is, you know, and that's what we've done with Quick Check, for example. We had no clue if people were really to lend money on mobile. So let's, you know, fake it, wireframes, and then people were downloading the app. So I think in the first 3 or 4 days, we had like 400 or 500 downloads. So like, okay, there's something. Now we need to build the first thing. How do we, you know, how can people lend money? So I don't know if it perfectly answers your questions, but I say, you know, then of course, if you're in a hardware business, for example, it would be a bit more difficult, because then you have to, you know, what's exactly the prototype? But today there's hundreds of different things. You know, 3D printing is a good example, or you can, you know, just do a nice video. You know, if you look at Kickstarter, some of them they don't even have a specific product or prototype yet. So they just sell the ID. I mean, if it's good enough, then people will be ready to buy and pay you to build a product.
So it is just like doing a survey on your ideas, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Great, thanks. So thank you very much. I'll be here after. And I'll just finish on this slide about, you know, taking risk. And thank you very much for listening to me. And I wish you all the best for tonight. And I hope to see you in any of your markets pretty soon. Thank you.